we're back in the shop, and Jimmy Doolittle didn't have to figure out how to get his control system linked up, but that's one of the things we need to work on in the course of this tape. We have a couple of ideas that are going to be very unique. I hope they're going to work. I guess we're going to find out. But as always, when you're a pioneer, there's a good chance you'll get an arrow in your back. One of the things we're going to do today, we're going to go up to servo meter again. This is, I've been looking forward to this day for quite a while. Today's the day. We have an appointment with them, and we're going to try to get them to help us resolve this problem in a, I guess an aerospace way would be the best way to say it. Now we're going to head up the servo meter, which is right here. And this is where we're going to have some time with the tech rep today. Now we spent a good 4 hours down at servo meter today, which is located about 45 minutes from my home. The people there, I met with their tech rep, Steve Wepp is his name, and they were just wonderful. They were absolutely wonderful, gave me a full tour of the place, offered to be part of our development project. Now you have to realize, when you make a plane like the B-25, this is not like building a, not even like a Miss Ashley or a Typhoon or something. We're having to invent a powertrain, an infrared, which not invent, but make it a little more complex, an infrared throttle control. We're developing the motors that hopefully are going to power the plane, in several different types of motors, in fact. So it gets complex, but the single most complex part of this whole project, and servo meter, this was one of the things I always enjoy is dealing with people who really know what they're talking about. Now Steve sat down with me, outlined what some of my choices were, gave me a lot of different thoughts for how to connect these, how they use these in industry. And anybody that's going to build a plane with dihedral, once we make our little test up, and basically we're not going to work on the model right now until we resolve how it is that we want to do this. But anyway, servo meter was gracious enough to, I would call it a semi-sponsorship of our project. And this is what I came away from servo meter with today, was a box of prototype samples to run my test with. And these are relatively expensive would be the right word. They're made out of solid nickel. That's, I'm not exactly sure how they make, they carve the part in salt, nickel electroplate it to a certain wall thickness, and then melt out the salt. But these bend around corners. And they have, we need about 5 degrees. They go up to about 12 degrees. So we're kind of excited about, well, we don't know if they're going to be appropriate, but it adds one more dimension into things that we can try and use, and we got some big ones here to try, some 3/8 ones. This is the most complex problem, and as far as I know, nobody that ever made a plane with a dihedral wing has come up with a solution that I'd be happy with anyway, a perfect, what I'll call a perfect solution. Now, these are really nice. Again, bonding them, I don't know how we're going to be able to bond them. We're certainly going to give this the all-American try. We're going to be looking at thinking outside the box, coming up with some ideas. A lot of it I'll obviously do off camera, since most people, this is something they just, you don't need to know every step of what's going on. What you do need to do is, if you decide to build a B-25, you need to get some of these or get something going. And again, this is our tech rep person at Steve Wepp, and he was extremely, extremely nice, pleasant to deal with, beyond pleasant to deal with. Went down to one of our local hobby shops that their specialty in life is RC cars, and I bought three different types, I'm not sure what I bought, just came home with $100 worth of stuff that I don't know if I'm going to use. These are little nylon universal joints, and they're made from a company called Traxxas, here's the number. Even have a number in England, that's interesting. Another little, and again, we don't know which one we're going to use, these little dog bones, I guess they call them, in the world of model cars. But they also had one that he's going to order for me that's like real automotive little universal joints that look absolutely out of control. $31 each, that would mean it's $150 for the universal joints. So we're going to try, and I'll do most of it off camera, we're just going to try to come up with some little technology that before we actually move on. But in the meantime, Tom Hampshire is going to stop by tonight if when he gets off work, and we're going to try to look over the jet motor. And he's got the Brodak 40 prototype with him, so that should be real neat. I just made up this little test. This is one of the little universal joints. And the weak part of this is that the set screws, even though I ground flats on the wire, the set screws are the weak link in this. But it will go around. Well, see, this is what I was just talking about. In fact, I stripped this set screw out already. So the problem here is, if I want to solder this, it's going to melt the nylon for sure. So what I'm going to do as an alternative here, I think I've resolved the problem, is I've called up the U.S. Hobby, and they have these that have a steel axle already machined onto them. So I think the next step in this is going to be to eliminate the nylon and get the little steel ones that are expensive. And in the meantime, I can experiment with some of the little servomatic ones. But this is going to take time. I know this is the sum total of a lot of thought that's going into this, and I don't want to do it any other way. I want it to be right. I made a little test piece here just for my own information. And put on it about the amount of torque. See, there's a bending, and from, even though I had high hopes for this system, what does happen is there's a point at which it kind of rotates, and then it breaks. And so, even though we spent a lot of time, and I really spent a lot of time making little tests of this up, now it gets better, especially according to the tech literature. If you stretch this out, it gets 100 times better, in fact. But the one thing you can't have with a bellows is that it's all squashed up together. As soon as it does it, it does that action. Now I have these two pieces JB welded in there, and I'm going to pull this. Oops. Yep. See now. And even though these look like, this is why you have to do the test. What I'm going to do is tomorrow, I'm going to have to, it's too late to go there now, go down to the hobby shop and get some of those steel. Now, the nylon universals are probably okay, but they do make steel ones. Because again, I'm really, really not willing to take any kind of chance that this won't work. The depth, the bowels of the earth comes.
Tom Hampshire's secret box.
The grease box.
The secret box.
No. The truth is,
he brought this great little bottle. Grip it, flip it, squeeze it.
You
get a bottle.
It to me.
You can buy these from Brodak now, $10.99. Look at this. We got cookies tonight. Pizza.
No, those are.
The purpose of Tom's visit here. We have the prototype. This is the prototype one. He's not in production yet, right?
One of four.
Okay.
One to me, one to Big Art, one to Tom Dixon, and one to Willis Swindell.
This is a Brodak 40.
It's a Brodak 40. It looks to be designed on the Double Star 40 stunt case.
Okay.
I don't have a Double Star 40 that I can measure from, but that backplate looks similar.
Yeah, it looks very
like
familiar.
A Fox, et cetera, et cetera.
Yeah, yeah.
But the top end, as you can see,
right,
is
more
on
fins.
The, right.
Okay, more fins.
And I don't know if you can get inside the critter here.
Okay. ABC, AAC?
ABC.
Okay.
And pretty much George Aldrich stunt numbers.
Okay.
I can tell you what. Now I left the timing sheet out in the car. But it's, in general,
basic stunt.
134 exhaust, 120 intake, 7 degrees blowdown per side, hemispherical combustion chamber.
Small Venturi, relatively small?
No, not now. This is not...
Oh, you opened it up.
Yeah, their Venturi was 275.
Okay.
This is a 290, but with
a 155 spray bar. That's a pretty thick spray bar.
Yeah. Okay.
But when I
and it's a through center spray bar, so that's
yeah.
Yeah.
Right. You have to equate the cross sectional areas.
Yep.
If it's a true Venturi like Jet's engine, it's gonna that hole is gonna turn out to probably be 165, 170.
Yeah. Yeah, Mike. We'll pull this all apart.
We'll measure all this stuff. This one I have not measured yet. I got it Friday afternoon on my back porch when I got home from work.
Okay.
So I have to say,
what a shame that now here's a that isn't a 35. Then we'd have a real B20 for three different.
Then, but
we'd have some real fun.
The real shame of it is here we've been tuning motors, cutting heads, cutting Venturis, dropping sleeves, grinding boy, yada yada, for 15 years chasing this stuff because nobody wanted to trouble themselves to build one. Now, in the same weekend,
we got two of them.
I have to shortchange either Brodak or Windy by doing the other guy's testing first.
No, do Brodak's first.
What
do
a
Brodak's
choice.
First. Yeah, no,
what
Brodak
a
comes
that's
first.
How I did it, and I owe you an apology for that because I didn't return your phone call.
The B25 is not a have to be done by this year project. It's feel like
it's
doing it.
The labor of love.
Yeah,
that's true.
Yeah.
But anyway, this thing has now had 15 flights.
Okay.
The first.
Benedetti was all excited. He said it was real user friendly.
Yes, but that was in an airplane of mine, a flying tail stutter with no flaps.
Okay.
32 ounces on 540 square inches. So the wing loading was 8.7 ounces per square foot.
Okay, so that's not going to kill anybody.
Rubber bands can do that.
Yeah.
Do a vertical 8 when the SIG quarter inch rubber twisted up into knots.
Okay.
It was real good then, but the proof of the pudding was Senator Benedetti loaned me a magician he has. That thing must be 40 years old. It's black and white checkered silk.
Okay.
It's about six magicians all made into one.
Right.
It weighs 44
kilos. Now that's a test. Yeah.
Yeah.
Now
you're 44 ounces, and it.
Even, I've always found it's the weight more than the aerodynamic.
That's
it's the weight that makes
the
difference.
You've got an engine that's cranking out the torque. You can drag anything up there. Well,
if you get the weight low, any engine will pull it.
Yes.
It's when you have a heavy plane,
and
you've got
one,
everything
And
right.
Here's one for Doug. Doug, I really thought the Packard emblems on the side of the magician. You just blew my fuses.
No, he was excited Sunday.
And I was real happy with the way it handled that grossly overweight airplane. It kept on chugging. Now, it's not
going to part before it's ever been run the jet. The head is basically very similar to the 60, 50 line of motors, and the 40, of course, which I don't have a 40, but. No idea what nice workmanship is in this. Now, this one is aluminum.
Yeah, that's AAC, for sure. Strange, okay? It's Schnarl ported, meaning it's got two intake ports that cause impinging columns of mixture to come together and get squirted upward. That's why it can run with no baffle. Then it's got a boost port that opens last that's intended to push more charge in, but only after the two impinging columns have blocked this last charge from coming in, going across the piston crown and right out the exhaust port. You can always tell your orientation because the exhaust port is always the highest port in the engine. It helps me to remember that the old has to go out to make way for the new.
Hey, I don't like to hear that old going out. I don't like that. That technology's got to go.
Let the record reflect that the man on the other side of the camera has the same hairdo I do.
No,
it's as gray as old snow.
What does Chicky have to say about this?
Anyway. That's exhaust.
Okay.
It's helpful to note here, if we had a Sport 40 or a Racing 40 or a Combat 40 sleeve, we would see that the difference in height from the upper lip of the exhaust port to the upper lip of the intake port would be about 45 or 50 thousandths. This is about 25, 30 thousandths.
That means these intakes have already been lifted. We don't have to grind them to make the blowdown about 7 degrees. We shall see about that as the evening progresses and we get to run some numbers.
That's the grindstones, Scott.
Yeah, right. But it looks like we don't have to futz with grinding.
No, I think he's got, and that's why I wanted to measure him. Tom's going to do the measurement. We're going to take the whole motor apart and measure it.
Yeah.
That's the whole objective of us spending this time here.
Dub gives me a very nice groove in the side of the sleeve there. Doesn't engage a pin, but it tells me how to orient the sleeve so the exhaust port in the sleeve is facing the exhaust port in the case. For the same reason, when I put this head back together tonight, I'll assemble it now without the button and so you can see it. Won't hurt now, the orientation doesn't matter, but after it's been run, I usually will take, and Wendy, your Webers for the B25 are set up this way.
You already did them, okay.
Yes, if you pull the head to change the deck height, the shims.
Right, you've got a scratch on there somewhere.
There's an E on the exhaust side.
Gotcha.
That means that when you put the engine together, you reassemble the same way. Most of the time, if nothing is wrong with my life that day, I'm able to keep the screws in the same orientation. I'll always try to do that. Keep the screws in the holes they came out of.
Okay.
And that's the typical most modern technology. It's got that pinch at the top.
Yes. Yes.
All the hot, relatively new engines have that technology.
Right. Now he's got.
The features of this motor is you could make it, Tom, we don't know for sure. You could put the exhaust on either side, which would be in it, or you could make a rear exhaust, or in some cases, like Frank Williams, you could make a front exhaust.
You can make a front exhaust, and I, for one, think that Senator Williams was on the right track, tooth, because he got the hottest part of the engine facing the onrushing.
Well, it didn't take long for the motorcycle guys to figure that part out, huh? Anyway, we're not going to do it now, but we do have the option of, when we do the B25, of making that the cylinders would both exit on the outside or both on the inside, or we can vary that. That's a nice thing. Or we can make two rear exhaust setups here, I guess.
Put one bolt, and I may have to find a
just
shorter
the liner in place.
But I always
the liner
like,
doesn't pop up when you get
always,
the top dead center.
I always like to put a nylon washer
right,
on the
correct.
Bolt so you don't chew up the corner of the sleeve and bust up your compression seal on the way to measurement land. But these bolts are too long, so I'm going to have
to... You got shorter ones. Okay.
We'll have to look in the junk pile here and see if we can't come up with something a little less even place. So now...
While you're doing your measuring.
I can feel it going over the pinch.
Okay, and you can find top dead center.
Yep, and we can measure away to our heart's content. Now, since I'm clump,
oh, you got your own mic? Okay. What do you think the timing is on this bird, Tom?
Chickies.
Are these valve events we're talking about?
I don't know. He's eating your shirt or something here.
I don't care if he eats my shirt. It's just I'm hoping nobody left a little extra detergent and said shirt under the collar. That won't be funny.
I'll give you a fun project. You know that biplane that Steve Busso designed a couple of years ago, that Hyperbipe?
I never saw
real high aspect ratio, like a 35 ship.
I never saw it.
Ron Merrill's making a one for a SATA 100, and he doesn't know how big to make it, 1,500 or 2,000 square inches.
Go for the big wing, baby!
What is there to decide here? Do we want a Harley or a real? This is a guy that has a motorcycle with a car engine now. What size will we make that? Don't put the 72 in there. Forget it. Now, you're referencing all your dimensions on a timing wheel of bottom dead center?
Yeah. Yeah.
Same as when you do motorcycles. That's
same.
Pretty. Okay.
Okay.
That's kind of standard, I think, with all two-cycle engines.
Yeah. It's a little weird, but it's not bad. Now, one thing that will help me tremendously... Oh, boy. Now, what we're going to do here, get the light pointed in the port.
don't know if this will come out, but we'll try.
And just get it pointed up and move it up so the lights go out. That gives me an idea where I am with the wheel, and it gets the piece to tell me that the piston is wiggling smoothly over the port, okay? The guys who do this and then backtrack into reworking FPs or so,
right,
and want to start to grind ports. There's one little trick that's helped me tremendously to avoid damaging pieces. When you grind the port, you raise lips, and you have to go into the bore with a scratcher. You can use the corner of a file in a pinch. I have a deburring tool that I built and ground to shape that fits my hand and fits the sleeve. You scrape where you've ground very carefully. You try to get all the bores out, and you never get it perfect, and you're always at risk of ruining the piece because you left the bore up, and if you put the piston in and move it up,
chunk,
put a scratch through the compression band.
Right.
You just made a nice aquarium ornament. Mail it into window, because
right,
that's all it's good for.
It's tip weight now.
It's toast.
There's right,
not,
right.
You can avoid that problem if, after you grind the ports and after you deburr as carefully as you can, the first time you put it together, put the piston in upside down with the rod first. That way, if there's a burr lifted, you find it the hard way.
Catch it on a skirt instead
of
the
cup. But you put a little tiny scratch down at the bottom of the piston skirt.
Mm. 16,000
RPM, they'll never see
nope,
it. The piston's a blur anyway.
Yeah, it's the top.
You
that
know
matters.
That's going to find your burr, the one that you missed. You can figure out where it was by looking at the sleeve when you pull
right,
it apart.
Right.
Deburr that, and you're safe as houses. That one trick, it will save you.
If it only saves you $100 piston,
if it
$100
saves you
or
$100 piston and liner set,
yeah,
you made the cost of the tape back. Now, I'll use it if I have to pull a Venturi. You can see that this Venturi is made right. It's got a taper here,
right,
and it flares out into a bell mouth.
Right.
The reason I cut these things is you can wrap them around the Venturi, grab it with a pair of fingertip vice grips.
Right.
Turn the engine over, sit it on a block, and wrap the vice grips with a block of wood, and it'll pop a tight Venturi out
right,
without leaving any tool marks
right,
on it.
You don't want to do the Jimmy Casale thing, pliers.
No, no.
Pipe wrenches.
Gas pliers are upstairs in your wife's tool chest.
Right,
you don't need
right,
gas pliers, okay? What we can do with this thing, however, because it's soft, is stick it in the exhaust port and use the piston to push it up as high as we can get it. Now we've got, guess what? The plastic supported right at the top of the exhaust port. Okay? Because I've used the piston to pinch it
right,
against the top of the exhaust port. Now we can take and set our depth measurement against the plastic, which we know is at the height of the port. That's the height of our exhaust port. Now we take it apart, pinch the calipers into place, and we can get our exhaust duration now. I'm going to check it by looking at the light that's coming in the door, and sure enough, the lights just go out
right,
when the piston
at
hits the base
point,
of the
At some point, that
calipers,
light just, for people that can't really see it on the video, at some point, that light just disappears.
Yes, it's
there's
right,
a point at which it shuts.
And it attenuates a little, and then it goes out.
It's out, yeah.
Right, and that's right where I am now. So what I'm going to do now is just hold the calipers in position and measure. And I'm right at zero. So that's 10, 20, 30, 40, 50, 60, 70, 80, 90, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Wow. Hello. I'm getting 154 degrees exhaust. So let's try it out. 10, 20, 30, 40, 50, 60, 70, 80, 91. 10, 20, 30, 40, 144. Let's do it again. 2.
If we do it long enough, it'll be 0.
7, 8, 9, 10. 110, 120, 130, 140. Okay, so we got 144 degrees of exhaust duration.
144.
Let's write that down. Oh, you
this is
going to
be powerful, huh?
Whee!
Okay. How big is the Venturi?
185.
185?
Yeah. Yeah. True. You're going to make a lot of photos.
That's the size the 60 is.
You're going to make a
You know what he did?
Photos.
He used the 60 Venturi. Yeah.
I don't know.
Oh, man.
I don't know.
Oh, I hope Hummel has fun with this. Now listen, Hummel, we're going to send you this motor tonight. This motor's coming up by you. Anyway, Tom's got his data sheet almost filled out.
Okay. I passed 120. Okay. The half of 24 is 12 degrees of blowdown. That's going to be real, real stout. The other thing that's going to make this engine run in a probably harsh and not user-friendly way is the chamber shape. If you look, I put the head back on, I shouldn't have before you took a picture, but let's look at the sketch. You've got a squish band at 150, an eighth of an inch is 125, this sketch isn't to scale. A squish chamber of 0.460 by 110. What's going to have to happen here is he's going to have to run that squish band out.
Like a hemi head.
Exactly. He's got to make that squish band no wider than about 50 or 60 thousandths and keep the rest.
But because it's a button head, it's easy to do. We can ask him for a couple of buttons and make three or four different.
We can fix this button and adjust.
Yeah. After Hummel's done. But Hummel, you're going to have to button up the head.
But Bill should run this at the beginning and just see what we've got. How about a WD-40? Something.
Try to get the WD-40 on the floor where you're going to walk when you're carrying your good blend.
There's extra points if you get it. I'm told if you get it in the video.
Oh, yeah.
You get thrown all the way over the World Trade Center's remains and into the East River, over New York City.
Well, that's got a nice pop.
Oh, yeah. Oh, this is.
Now, what I'm seeing, though, is from the timing and stuff, this is going to be more than a mild engine. This is going to be a hot rod.
This is timed about like the typical RC sport engine.
Okay.
This is going to want to come up on the two-stroke and stay there howling at you.
Okay.
The only thing that it's got that's a plus is the guys who made this can whip up another one.
Yep.
It's probably 20 or 30 keystrokes.
What kind of pressure reading you getting?
47, let's say, which is not that high. The compression gauge has a dead volume up in here, so it doesn't mean anything about the real world base compression of the engine. Because of this extra volume, all this thing does is give me an engine-to-engine comparison about where we are. It doesn't tell me what the number is in this engine.
Okay.
This one is at 47, which is mid-range on compression. But you need to get into the theory of how you measure a compression ratio and how you set the benchmark. If you look at it in a textbook, it'll tell you that the compression ratio is the swept volume, 0.3598 inches, plus the top volume, divided into the swept volume alone, and that's what gives you the typical 8, 9, 10 to 1 compression ratio. Mm-hmm. That's not real world. Real world in a two-stroke, the amount of pressure you get in the cylinder is very dependent on the exhaust timing. A Stun engine with real low exhaust ports and a real long effective stroke above the port, it's going to have a much higher compression
power
ratio
stroke,
than a pylon engine that has the exhaust ports up next to the head and has an effective compression stroke of something like half the rotational angle of the crankshaft. Right. That's going to have an exhaust duration up to 155 or 160 if it's a real designed to scream and do nothing else.
Well, I want to thank Tom Hampshire for a great night. Chicky enjoyed his company.
Get out of here.
Anyway, we did. And I hope you've enjoyed sharing some of the stuff we're doing with the jet. Hey, he's on TV too. With the jet engines, and the Brodak engine is coming. The jet engine is coming. We're going to have a lot of great test flying to do this summer. And now it's time to get back to the B-17. Back to the B-25. Back to the Cardinal. I don't know. I don't even know where we're going anymore. Anyway, while we're doing all this, all our sprayed on coats of clear Brodak dope have been drying up day after day while we're doing our look at this, he's up on top of the wing now. You're going to live. You're out of here. You're going to live with somebody you're not going to enjoy being with, Chicky. Your worst nightmare. I'm out of here. had this morning, we have an incredible break in the weather here. It's supposed to go to 70 degrees today. And I really wasn't, you know, I was going to do other work on this before I put the first coat of silver on, but what I thought is I'll take advantage of the day, get the first coat of silver on this and get it drying while I'm working on that control system, the horns, and some of the other composite projects like the Strega cowls that we're trying to inventory right now. Again, that time management thing, I've always taken advantage of a day, and in the case, remember, I don't know if you remember when we did put the clear on Miss Ashley? Wow, that's all just sitting there. That is going to buff out in nothing flat. That's already a couple of weeks old. Getting the paint on and getting it drying in this warm weather, be a giant advantage, a giant help. And we have an exceptional day here.
I mean, this is the most unbelievable rare thing. Again, because this is the first coat of silver, I'm just spraying it on. It's actually going to be a coat of filler. But the idea of doing this is that we will get this an extra day or two to dry out while we're working on those control system parts. Now it's amazing how quick the silver brings up the floors, and I can see a bunch of them already getting the aggravated. Just when you think you have it all sanded out nicely. As soon as you think you have it, that you're real happy with it, you go and spray the silver and... Anyway, I'll finish doing this. This is going to dry, and we'll get an extra day of drying on this, a day or two. Is I can look at this in the sun and I can see little spots that are a little dry. Let this kind of kick off and I can get an extra little bit of silver in there. I can get on the tape. See, this is the spots I've been putting extra on where the joints at a fiberglass end. Out here there's a spot where I sanded through. Let's see, it's right about here. So I'm doing just let it dry up. Give it a half an hour or so and I'll come back out and put another coat of silver on this. As I look around, I can see there's a spot somewhere here. You can see little spots here and there. Once that's all dried up, yeah, that silver is the whole thing that allows you to find out, to go to the next level where it's really perfect, it's really museum quality, you don't have any little glitches in the finish. Very labor intensive, but boy, when it's done, does it really looks nice. As we go into the now B20, B25, why do I want to call this a B29? That'll sit out there all day drying with our roof fan going. And in 60 degree weather, that's going to cook nicely. You can come back and work on this tomorrow.
Now what I did today is... I took all those universal joints back, the plastic ones, the nylon ones, and I wound up, you can see the price here, the $34, $33 each. But these are case hardened. Now, I spoke to the guy in the hobby shop, Ron is his name, and he said these are probably the strongest ones they make. I don't know if you can see how nice these are. But the reason I've spent so much time and energy, and now we're going up toward $100 on these, there's a pretty simple reason. These are nicely made, by the way. Boy, there is no friction in this at all. But one of the things I really wanted here is a permanent solution. I don't want to have what I'm going to call a temporary solution. And I have to figure, of course, some way to join these and in some way to... I've spent a whole week trying to come up with a solution here, because it's not only a solution for me, it'll be a solution for everybody that ever builds a plane that has dihedral and wants to use this system, assuming it works. We'll find out. But anyway, we've kind of abandoned the bellows. I made other little tests with that, and that really was, I just don't think it's strong enough for this. I wouldn't hesitate to use it on an older size plane, but on something this big, I'm just there. And by the way, the number of this product is, if you wanted to buy one of these, they have a part number. It's HP1A517. And by the way, at the store, they had 20 or 30 different ones that have longer and shorter legs. These look to be... Now the thing that happens with the bellows, when you're turning it this way, there's no problem. But as you go into an angle, you get a side load that's really hard to deal with. Now this, of course, there's no side load. This is just an ordinary universal joint. So if this works, and if we can engineer up in the next couple days, a control horn, and I wanted to do a little test. Dave Downey and I kind of had an idea of making torque box flaps using an arrow shaft for the leading edge. Now, conveniently enough, this would plug right into an arrow shaft. Again, because they're case hardened, I looked at all the other choices here, and I'm going to fool with this for a while. And I'll do it off camera because I know this is not something everybody's real concerned with. But this is a key part of any semi-scale. If you want to make a Corsair, if you want to make other planes that we really like, is the A26, for instance, you have to be able to put some dihedral in the tail or the wing or something. This looks like it is really one good solution. Again, we'll find out. This is where it can really wear you down day after day, but at least I know while I'm fooling with this, my silver is outside drying.
Now, if you only knew how many hours I put into this, it's embarrassing. Could have made a whole tape on, just had to make one of these horns. Now, what I've done, I've used Stay-Brite because I don't want to make the metal be tempered. This is tempered steel. I'm just getting a wet, smooth joint on there. I'm going to let that cool, give it the baking soda and water treatment once it cools. And we'll decide how we're going to do the arms. I was looking at two possibilities of using arrow shafts, and that got a little complicated and heavy, or making a coupler, and I want this to cool normally, making a coupler and just making 1/8-inch horn arms. Okay, we're going to find out how this works as soon as that cools down.
Now you might think this just took an hour or so to make. Wrong. This was really time consuming. Now, one of the problems that I've had, I want to attach this to a piece of 1/8-inch wire. I measured out how wide the fuselage was, allow 1/4 inch for some kind of fillet or clearance. I originally started thinking I would plug this into an arrow shaft and run an arrow shaft to the leading edge. And I thought, well, I talked to Dave Downey about that, and he thought it was a good idea too, but when I weighed out all the parts and made a little test, it just got too heavy. Now I have a nice smooth area here where I can get my bushing in. I have three choices of control, which will be pretty much 1:1, 5:4, and 3:2, the usual. So the next part of this equation, and boy, I tell you, I'm fatigued from doing this, is I'm going to have to cut these off and come up with some kind of a coupler to couple this onto my 1/8-inch horn ends, and then make sure, of course, that they're both parallel and they're both 90. Now, this is the material I use. I wanted to put this on, this hex material. And what I did, I cut both of the pieces off, cut a piece of that hex material to make a joint. And what I wanted to do is I wanted to have the hole in the upright a hex shape, so it would add a little strength to this joint. Now the next thing, of course, I wanted to, this is what I was going to do, I had these upright, I don't want to use copper tubing, and boy, that's the last thing in the world. But I want to get something that'll be a tight fit. These are a little bit too sloppy. I have some other electrical connectors, but I need some connectors, and I would prefer steel if possible. But it looks like this is such a little bit of work. Boy, is this a lot of work. Trust me, but this really, I hope, is going to solve. There's no side load like there is with the spring and with the other gizmos. In fact, you almost can go around a 90-degree corner with this. We'll find out. But this has been the single hardest part I've had to make so far on a B-25. I did. I took some eighth-inch wire and made like a horn with two layers of copper tubing, two thicknesses, one OD and another OD. And that looks like it'll work. I like that. Ooh, I like that better than the little crimpers. Now, in a joint like this, the trick is to get the parts tinned before you slip them together. You don't want to just put the tubing together and then solder it. You want to get the parts tinned both inside and out, just like doing plumbing work. So we'll solder on these little arms. It's like little boxing gloves. If you knew how long that took. Anyway, I got an email from Paul Walker today that I asked him how he did his B-17, and he did it with Lucky boxes, plywood boxes, so this could rotate in a box. Well, as a last resort, if we're not happy the way this comes out, we can give that a try. We're certainly going to find out one way or another here. Now, it'll be interesting to see. I tested these joints in a vise because they're double tubing, one over the other, and sweated inside each other. Now, once we mount this up, the important thing, and I remember from Steve telling me how important it was to get a bushing on both sides of these universals. Oh my God, we're going to see. Well, at least we know if the worst thing that can happen is we're going to have to start from scratch or make up a set of flaps with Lucky boxes. I've been trying to avoid that, but we'll see how this works out. And that's it for today. This is a whole day, believe it, this is a whole day's work. See you tomorrow. Let's get a look at how much stuff we had laying out here and how many boxes of stuff we had here and servo meter stuff and all this stuff. God, it's just unbelievable. This was some project. I just can't believe it. Well, the main thing is we'll see tomorrow whether it works or not. I come down here this morning and he's eating all my tubing. Hey! Hey! Get away from that tubing! That's it, baby. Anyway, today, I have to cut some of this away so I have some room to work and just see if I'm going to be able to mount this horn in a practical way. I have to make up the little bushings. That'll be the initial project today, and if we have a little time, you can see we still have some spots where I've sanded through on previous times and the silver really exposes them. We'll look at doing a little dressing off of some of the silver here. Again, because we have this time window of, we have some really nice weather here, some real warm weather, in fact. I don't know if it's supposed to rain or not. But see, this is the reason you shoot silver. See, you'd never see that without the silver. This we did see. All this will be filled right in. When this is all done, I want it to look as perfect as I can before we go on to making the nacelles. Let me see if I can cut some of this wood away here and figure out how we're going to mount that horn up. If I could get that horn mounted up today, that would be a major thing. Get away. Look at this. He just never quits. You want to work in a restaurant? You can be the chicken. Tastes like chicken. Get out of here. Wait for my tools. I just wanted to show, I don't know if I ever showed this on the tape before. These are carbide cutters that Scott Smith got me many years ago. But they really are, they never wear out, period. Not cutting wood, they're never going to wear out. They almost don't wear out when you cut steel, but in a case where you want to cut eighth inch plywood. Now this is funny, he got me this like as kind of a little thank you for some of the, I think I did a demo up there or something, I don't remember. But all these little carbide cutters, what this is, I'm just starting to realize how handy these were. I never wanted to use these because I thought this was kind of like a neat little award, but I've been starting to use them. And some of these, especially these, the ones that never were out, they really do, the ones for hollowing blocks and stuff, and the ones for cutting. I would say a set of those carbide cutters, that is if you're looking for a nice birthday present or something, this, that's a great one. Now, I want to finish off this edge. I don't know what shape I want to make this, but I want some room so I can start fitting in this. This will just give me just about enough room once I finish that off. Again, I'm not really convinced that this is the ultimate answer here, but I certainly, because we've come this far already, I want to see if this is going to be a practical way, and if it isn't, we're not married to it. We've dumped three or four other systems, and this may be the next one. I cleaned off all the silver filler. Now what I'm going to do is get a brand new blade. Well, first I have to make the bushings up and lay out where my bushings are actually going to go. I want the bushings, the little tin straps that are going to be the bushings, to go into this solid trailing edge, which is already fiberglass, so it'll give me something hopefully pretty solid to mount it to. Get some tin material and make up the little bushings. To make this system work well, both sides of the universal need to be in bushings. They can't be out in midair. The closer I can get to the universal joints with this, the better it'll be. Okay, I made up all the four little bushings because I want to confine these as close to the universal joints as possible. Now I need to lay out where these little slits are going to be and how much I'm going to have to notch out at a trailing edge. And this would be very similar to how I'd confine a horn if I were, for instance, molding a typical stun ship without universal joints. It looks funny. It looks like a worm walking around there. Like Chicky's getting excited looking at that. Maybe he can eat it or something. Now, even at this point, I have everything set in there. I was really disappointed with the way there's just slop in the universal joints already, and after just doing little tests that I can't resolve reasonably. There's, if you can see it here, it was just developed little slop, maybe from a welding operation or brazing or whatever. So I don't know, I wanted to think about this over a cup of coffee, but what I'm going to do as an alternative now, I'll try Paul Walker's little trick. Well, I don't know if it's Paul Walker's trick, Al Ravy's trick, somebody. I hate the idea of using lucky boxes, but it certainly looks like we've run out of options here. We've run out of all of the things that I thought would be worth trying, and certainly we've gotten a good education on this. And we'll have this as a backup alternative way of doing it, but right now I can see that I'd be unhappy with that little amount of slop that's already developed, and we haven't even flown the plane yet. We haven't even run the engines. And possibly this would be the weak link, and I'd have to replace this after the model was already finished. So rather than do this, I'm just going to make up an ordinary control horn. And possibly, I hate to throw the towel in, but and live with the fact that we're going to have lucky boxes on this plane. Maybe I can line them with some tin or some brass or something so they'll wear a little bit better. Again, we'll find out. But this was a very time-consuming experiment. Time-consuming. But you know what? The truth is, education isn't cheap or free. And now I feel comfortable knowing, I know at least, that this is not going to be a reasonable approach. Now, even though I have probably 500 horns here and all kind of odd shapes and sizes and experiments, the biggest one I had wasn't quite big enough. It was just pushing it. So I'm going to have to make one from scratch. I'll do that off camera. We've done that on film many, many times. I need to make a horn, and I want to have at least a quarter of an inch of clearance on each side here. Anyway, boy, I'll tell you. Education is a hard thing. Learning in the real world. Anyway, but you'd never know this unless you made up this part or relegate this part now to the parts that, we had high hopes for. Now, I've never done a plane with lucky boxes, so this is going to be new to me. I'll make the horn up. So I had to make up a horn, and I'm going to have to reorient how this, because this, what I need to do is connect the center line, so this, I'll have to put a little filler block in here, I guess, since I didn't anticipate doing this.
You can tell I'm frustrated.
Listen, you better work. I'm going to send you to live with Ron Merrill if you don't work.
Anyway, I made myself three adjustments, which again will be 1-1, 4-5, and 3-2. I roughened up all the little pieces of tin bushing so that I'd get a good... it's hard to use it's hard to use CA in here. I don't want to melt the foam. I'll have to do most of this with epoxy.
I built this up with thin layers of 5-minute epoxy because I didn't want anything to melt the foam. I want to smooth this out. I'm going to reinforce it with some of that carbon fiber, the stuff that we make the carbon tanks out of. But that's still nice and solid in there. In fact, I may even get the push rod hooked up today.
Because this is not, I had to make a little filler block here, you can see. This does not sit, of course, in a V location.
And I'm not sure. I'm going to make up, one of the things I want to do is get the rest of the controls hooked up. I'm going to make a little test for my, and see if I can come up with something better or some improvement on rookie boxes. You can't believe how much that aggravates me that other stuff didn't work. But pioneers are always the ones that get arrows in the back. Now this is just a bit stiff here because the bushing is so long, but I know if I drop one drop of oil down in there, that'll wear right in. No matter what design you're building or whatever. If you need a little piece of this, by the way, I'll be glad to send it out to anybody because a roll of it is really expensive. And if you just need a little piece like for an application like this, I'm trying to line this up with where the fuselage sides would be, which will make it even stronger. And just let that sit. Don't use any kicker, it'll just make the sanding easier. And by the way, it is easy to sand right through this stuff. And we just wrap it around and put it on the other side too. I want redundancy here. Yep, I always say life is an adventure, and this control system in this plane has been a wild adventure. I check these lucky box things. I've never done them before, but since Al Raby and Paul have both suggested that that's the best way to go. Now when I do the bottom, of course, I like to avoid putting any thin CA anywhere near the horn. Because like I said, I have had, and I'm sure other people have had too, has had some CA get down into that. That's the reason I don't use those brass tube bushings anymore. Boy, that was a failure. And you could throw a whole plane away if that horn locks up. That's just really a pain. Now I'll trim this off, being careful I don't cut right through the wood. So the adventure continues. And my goal is to get this control system set up today. And by the way, this would work. This is an excellent way of doing this. Just no kicker. No matter what. Even though we're making, a relatively unusual plane, a lot of the things you can peel off the video to use for your own personal use, just like with anybody's video. Once that has a chance to kick, and this is a nice, neat, very lightweight way to do it. Now I can bury that with a little more CA. Sand it a little bit, get it even, just for, so it has a nice appearance. That's a good way, by the way, and again, any horn, any plane, anytime, anywhere, that'll work.
Next thing I'm going to do today is hook up the controls. I had to move this up about an eighth of an inch so I could get this angle just right. to line that up without hitting anything. In other words, as you raise the bell crank, this slot gets bigger, which is not a good thing, and there might be some other way of, maybe putting a push rod on the bottom. Now, I want a straight line to the horn. See, every time you get too cute, but that's where I need it. Now, the way I make this adjustable to get the fine tuning is I make a slot in here. Just a little bit of a slot instead of a hole, and then I fill it with epoxy once I get neutral set on that. And that's, again, that's another thing you can use on any model, even on a profile model. Now, the first thing here before we even drill this out is to get this in neutral. Figure out when neutral is on. I'm going to bell crank, and luckily we can see right in there. Now we need to take into account a little bit of adjustment so we can cut this right about there. So you just trim this off now. Again, being able to make this last little bit of adjustment is a critical thing. Because otherwise you have to build it, you have to make the wire. And let's be honest, not many people cut it right the first time. Now I measured this piece off as to where I want to have the slot. And what this will allow me to do, by having a slot in here, it's going to allow me to fine tune this just a little bit. And that's what I want. Another thing that I've seen people do that's really bad is they don't trim this off with a little stub of it sticking out. You want to have a little bit of this sticking out. And of course, needless to say, a precision drill. So this is I can hardly move it, in fact. But a nice tight fit on the wire, not a sloppy fit, because that's going to eventually be a problem. Now I've marked where I want the both ends of this to be. I may not need that much adjustment. Now, if I need more than that, then I'll bend another piece of wire. Now, I need to trim this out so just enough sticks up. Now, one of the tricks to getting the wire a nice tight fit is put that in first and then slide the arrow shaft end in. I might have cut this too short. I'm getting too cute here. See, what I'm trying to do is make as tight a fit as possible. I've got that just a little bit too long now. After a little test fit, you can see here's the problem. I just put this in temporarily, is I have more down flap than up flap. So what I want to do, in essence, is shorten this. Now, I haven't pushed this all the way in yet. So what I can do is, you see, I can move this rod back down and just open up that hole. Just a slightest little bit will give me that travel, too. Now, before I lock this in, I want to check with my little protractor to make sure I have the same amount up and down. That looks like it's close. And as soon as it is, I'm going to fill this with CA, push this in all the way, and I'll be ready to solder my washer on. But having this, I can fine-tune this adjustment. You pretty much can see how I can do it without even having to bend a new piece of wire. And it's a good idea to wrap this with some carbon tow. Again, if you don't have any, I can send you a piece of foot long. It'll last for a long time, a couple of planes. Now, before I actually glue this in, what I do, Take a flat piece of paper. This is just to check my eyesight. And I can run a line. And I can take this on the bottom. And I can get the last 1 degree or 2 degrees. In this case, we're pretty close, believe it or not. And just make sure we have equal travel. You could do it with a piece. You can put it in a fuselage and mark it, do it with a protractor. Just roughly, I want to make sure I have the same amount up and same amount down. And that this is in neutral when the bell crank's in neutral, another significant thing. Now, one of the things before I'm going to tack this, I'm going to fill this with thin CA here. And then I want to check and let some of it run down in here. As soon as that kicks a little bit, see, I don't want this to be really totally permanent, that I can't break it loose, because once this is tacked, then I want to check it again. Now the last thing is I'm going to fill this with some thick CA and then wrap this with some carbon tow.
I fill that with CA, I don't know if you can see that with the macro lens. And I just need to do the wrap with some carbon tow. Solder the washer on.
And we will have ended, well, at least up to this point, ended one of the frustrating parts of this model. And the reason I say if you need a piece of this is a roll of this is very expensive, and I've never seen anybody sell small amounts. Now I have seen in planes that were extremely old, over 10 years old, I've seen these. When you take them apart, what happens? These arrow shaft ends split. So don't forget that there's no weave going this way in an arrow shaft. So rather than take a chance, I would rather be safe than sorry. And this also adds a little material up around where that little spike that's coming out of there is. One valid point, rather than using kicker, a Q-tip kicks it at a slower rate. You don't get all the bubbling and popcorn. Well, you get less anyway. The point is, with a take-apart plane, if this joint were to start to fail and you catch it, it'd be fine. But on a plane that you're building that's one piece, once you seal a fuselage block, and you almost never get to see this again. Funny, back in the 60s, I was one of the first ones, maybe not the first one, I'm not sure, to start putting eighth-inch horns in planes and heavy-duty controls and things like that. And I always thought, well, yeah, there's a weight penalty, maybe a half ounce or something, but boy, somewhere down the road, does that pay? And this is the kind of stuff that, yeah, you'd like to make this ultralight model and everything, but this is one part. If it fails, boy, you think we had a bad day today. Now I'm just painting this with thick CA. That'll kind of fuel proof any loose spots that are in there. I'll solder on a washer, put my normal redundancy system of grinding a notch in the wire. And that's strictly for redundancy. Now one side benefit here is even if this washer comes off, I doubt if this is going to go anywhere because the slot that we have where the push rod's coming out is confining it somewhat. So we almost have a triple redundancy here for this. It's pretty short end. Some people like to just solder a washer. They solder a washer on both sides or whatever system they use. But the way I like to do it, no matter what, is get a notch in the wire so that I can put a little piece of wire around there. So even if the solder joint fails in time, we're talking 10, 12, 15 years, whatever, forever. My lifetime anyway. But we still don't have this come jumping off and boom, and the plane goes in. And that really gives you a nice redundancy. You wrap some copper wire in there. I have eyelets that are a tight fit on the wire. What happens if you have a sloppy fit on the washer, the heat goes in, softens the solder on the bushing, and sometimes you can have the part actually solder right to the bushing, which we don't want either. Now that's a nice tight fit. Now I'm going to get a couple wraps of thin copper wire on there too. Now you can get this wire from Brodak, this thin wire. But it's a good redundancy, and the test of a good redundancy is if you don't need it, it's even better. It's like wearing a crash helmet. The best crash helmet in the world is if you never need it. Did you ever see a dream?
I can just get this as tight as I can and let it just fracture wherever it is, because we're going to solder this. But having that eyelet real tight or washer prevents that heat, the solder, from running under there and soldering your bushing shut. Now whatever solder we put on there will be a real good redundancy. Now a little piece of tinfoil protect it just in case my ace soldering job are falling down into the foam wing. Or my choice would be to always use Stay-Brite silver solder, deflux it with baking soda and water. Had real good luck with this over the years. This has been a long day. I'm glad it's over. New old shop hours, but I wanted to make a little sketch of when these controls are in. See, even though I should be upstairs sleeping right now, I wanted to make a sketch of just how big this box or this sliding area has to be. And you can see that's how much that horn rotates. Now let me show this. See how this works in the full down position. But as this goes up, it rotates. So what I need to do is measure this, and it looks like it's more than a half an inch. This is how wide I have to make those boxes tomorrow.
Have to be about a half an inch as these slide in and out because of the dihedral. Roughly a half an inch. I want to make sure I don't have any burrs in the wire here.
I did tonight with this little bit of time I had. What I wanted to do, I wanted to see how this box, and of course these are known as lucky boxes. If I'm just getting some idea of how strong that would be, because what happens is as this goes through its travel, this wire moves in and out. And I think about a half inch was the number that I thought I needed. Again, I'm sure going to find this out. But I can see a couple of things maybe I can improve here, and then I didn't take into account the thickness of the plywood. I need to make these boxes and then possibly just attach them to the end of the flap as one way of doing it, glass over it. And I'm not sure. Again, this is the kind of things when you can't sleep at night, you just come down to the shop and think about things like this. But this would be, we're going to have removable flaps anyway, but this would allow this. Now, we'll also be able to do this past the nacelle at the second joint, too. I don't know, I guess when you come down to it, this might be the only solution. I don't know why I'm still not convinced that this is the answer, but it certainly looks like, because I had never built one of these before. I think one of the things I can look at doing possibly is when we actually make the flaps is inset some tin can stock, or just some tin can stock down at the end here, measure out where the end is. Because again, this only has to go, it doesn't have to be this long, only to the end, and it needs to be about a half inch wide. Again, until you make one, you see, the things is, when you're thinking about these things, at least I am, a lot of things seem really like a great idea. Then you lay them up and you see, like in the case of the slop, what at the side load that the bellows were creating, but boy, we have sure gotten an education. And I'm still not convinced, but I'm getting more convinced as other things get eliminated. Possibly a little piece of tin can the size of a penny back here, because all of the load is at the end, and because it's a radius, it'll slide. And I'm not sure you couldn't come up with something even cuter than that, but maybe a little piece of tin can stock. Again, we're going to look at some of these possibilities. The main thing is that there's no binding on this.
I don't know, Casminato had this plane that the flaps just, they were in a notch like that. I kept looking at that and saying, geez, I don't know. But it worked. You know, a lot of things look kind of crude, but they work. This is one of them. Anyway, this was time well spent tonight. I feel a little bit better. When I come back tomorrow, at least I'll be able to sleep knowing I've kind of gotten a little handle on this.
One last thing before I go to bed here is I wanted to make room with some tin sliders to see just if that would be better than using plywood. Well, I don't know from a wear point of view, probably thin brass. Well, that certainly gives a nice, smooth, non-binding, and I guess you'd never wear it out. Again, this is just prototype stuff, and I want to know, just to give me some ideas as to how we want to do it, because this is not the next step. The next step is going to be, we have to lay out the nacelles, and if I don't have the drawings in tomorrow's mail, I'll sand out the silver on the wing, because the nacelles have to be in place before I make that first little flap. That's enough. Long night.
Now today, I wanted to do two things today. Since we make carbon fiber tanks, and when they go into cycle, and we did a dedicated video on this, so there's no point going back through it, but if anybody hasn't seen that video, just let me know and I'll get a copy to them. What it does, it takes 4 days to make up a tank, four cycles. So what I'm doing, as long as I'm working on customers' stuff right now, one of the things I wanted to do is make up the bodies for the tanks, because we're going to be working on nacelles real soon. Now the wing has been up there by the heating vents, so by the time we're done, it'll probably take 3 or 4 hours. We'll work on all of our other molding stuff, but anytime I give that silver to dry, it'll just make it a lot easier to sand out, and that silver does have just a little bit of talc in it, so that should be our real first coat of filler on a wing. And that gets us a nice bond through the whole wing. We have the silk span and the glass going span to span. And of course we're going to be using carbon fiber tanks in the plane, so as long as we're going to have the tooling out for the next week or so, I want to make some extra parts so when it comes time to actually make up the tanks and see how they fit in the nacelles, we'll have them made up. And I'll do this off camera, and when we get done with this, if we have any time left, we're going to work on sanding that silver out. Now just a couple of tips as we go along with our sanding of the silver. One of the things, when you have a foam wing as opposed to a built-up wing, I never want to get any water, any ammonia, anything with a water base anywhere near the foam wing. It can turn into a washboard just from the moisture. So the choice that I have is always using M600. And a lot of times, what I've become comfortable with lately is working with gloves, because the M600 can be, I have a lot of open cuts on my hands and using all this stuff that I do. So if you've never used rubber gloves, yeah, I would suggest you pick up a box, give it a try. In a matter of a week or so, you don't even know you have them on. But it's another good tip, and I've used it even when doing carbon fiber parts. Now one of the things, when you get to this point, now as soon as I put on a coat of filler that has, let's get this wet, Sikkens M600, as soon as I get to this point, I have one coat, this is the first coat of silver, just a little bit of talc in it. Now I don't want to get too anxious to try to do this all in one sitting. There's going to be a lot of little errors pop up. But basically when you look at this, especially relating to a foam wing, because there's no open bays, there aren't any open bays, everywhere you see it shiny is a low spot. Everywhere that we've sanded through, it's flat. So right here, we're done. But we're certainly not done here. Now a lot of times you can do this in one or two, I've done it in as few as two or three sand outs. And a foam wing usually will go relatively quickly, but the trick is not to get any water down by it.
Now, many times I've tried using Windex or soapy water or something, and the minute you break through, and there's one little spot where it ripples, it's just a real disaster. And I'm only picking this spot because it just happens to be an easy spot to do. Because the foam wing is almost all flat, I always want to kiss all the edges.
And constantly, as I say it again, constantly wipe. You don't want to leave the material on even anytime you don't have to. The thing should not be wet. Now, of course, the other choice is you can do it dry and it'll just take 10,000 sheets of sandpaper. But here's a spot. Now, this is where we are done. Here's where we're not done yet. So I can go back right around the edges and pick up spots. And I'm going to do this off camera. And as I come up on spots, there are a lot of spots on our foam wing, right? There's always spots. What am I talking about? But I'll try to put a couple of the key ones on and how we're going to go about repairing them. Good little tips for people doing a foam wing plane. For anybody that might have missed it, these spray bottles, you can use a Windex bottle if you have M600. It'll last about a couple of days anyway before the seal goes. You can pick one of these up relatively inexpensively. From Consolidated, there's the phone number, 216-425-3900. Again, you may try putting it in a dish. It'll evaporate before you get one wingtip sanded out, so that's not a good choice. But what we're trying to do here is make this as easy as possible. Each sand out, a sand out shouldn't be an all-encompassing, terrible, awful thing. It should be relatively quick. And we don't want to go through. The problem is once you break through, and we've already got a couple of spots on here. Let me just show them that we have to address where the paint is thin. See that dry spot right there? There's a couple other ones too, but we really don't want to. We try to get it as smooth as possible without breaking through. A tip, anytime I'm using M600, always have a fan blowing, always have some good ventilation. And actually, any chemicals, whether you're using Brodac Dope or any chemicals, even the ammonia, good ventilation in a shop. In my shop, I leave the fan on whenever I'm using any chemicals. And one of the things I've really gotten used to in the last 6 months is using these rubber gloves. And boy, when I used to have a little cut in my hand or a crack around a fingernail and it'd start bleeding and the M600 or thinner or something in it, it was unbelievable. Now it's something that's a lot easier to deal with. It's a good tip. And the gloves are relatively inexpensive. Beauty of using this system that I've used over the years and the way the silver has helped me is it first off it shows the flaws, we all know that, but also using these little polywogs now I'm able to go after little spots that looked sanded when the part was in wood but have proven not to be. Also these little parts that have angles, getting in these little corners and angles, I call it the detailing, I'm not sure if that's the right word, but by detailing the parts, I want to be real careful, this is only a piece of 64th plywood here, I don't want to squash it, but I wanted it so in case the lead outs wear against that. All edges, all corners, every time you sand, give each one a little spot. Now if there's a really deep gouge, I could fill it in with that green 3M material, or the blue, either one, or the red. This is the point at which a lot of people want to get through and go fly the model. They don't want to spend this extra day or half a day or whatever, but any time you spend, this is my feeling, if you spend an hour sanding silver, first off, you've made the model lighter, you've gotten rid of the flaws, you've probably gotten a couple appearance points more, and for the life of that model, it's a piece of artwork instead of a piece of wood. Now right here, I can see that, I can even feel that that's low now. Rather than sanding through,
I'm going to probably have to fill this when I'm all done with some of the 3M material, the filler. Now, you could just mix up a batch of... Well, actually, another thing we could do is just spray some Brodak primer in there. When you use Brodak primer, you want to sand every little bit off. And I usually spend the better part of about a half a day, detailing edges, but always sand every corner, every edge. And normally you can't do a foam wing at this point with a block. Once you sand in a silver, I'm only doing this in the edges and corners. And that old thing, we want to keep the inboard tip as light as possible too. Now you can see another spot, there's a seam right here. Let me see if I can get the light to reflect. Here, you can see it right here. See that little spot? Well, we'll sand that out. Same thing, we're just going to pick away at this for the remainder of the day and try to get this so that we have this first coat of silver filler is just giving us an idea of where the bad spots are and where we need to do a little more work. To show how long it should take to sand silver. It should not be, and it's easier to sand two or three thin coats than to put on three coats and try to sand it. This should not be, once you get into the flats of a foam wing, all of the flat areas should go very, very quickly. You can see how big of an area. I like to do an area about the size of a play-in card or an IBM card, one thing. And as soon as you're done, another good tip. Wipe around, because you don't want any running under the bottom. It just puddles up on the bottom and can be a, see how this is? It can be a problem, especially when you're doing clear. Now, it also shows you right away where we have another spot we have to work on a little bit. Okay, but that's the purpose of the silver. It's showing me a little spot up here. If I just went ahead and painted this, well, I may be deluding myself, or I'd be settling for a little bit less in terms of finish, and I'm never willing to sell. I really do not care if there's some other trade-off, but I want the planes to be pretty. It is the single most important reason I build planes, is I like the way they look. If they're not beautiful, or if they're unattractive in some other way, craftsmanship is crude, or they're not, in some way they're disappointing. Now that's just how quick, this should go very quickly from this point on. But if you have an idea of how much time is involved in this, the rest will be relatively easy to figure out. Now this can go real quick, as it did in this case. Here's the thing, though. I didn't want to mess my pad up, so I put a doubled over old bed sheet. And what I can do is just throw that right in the laundry. That can go right in the laundry now, and that's ready. I'll go outside while we have this warm weather and get another coat of silver on that. Well, that's going to sit and dry overnight with the second coat of silver on there. If we can get that up by the heating vent, get a couple of days drying on that while we work on other projects. It looks like maybe one more sand out and that'll be ready to go. That has been sitting up by the heating vent overnight. And I'm going to do the same thing I always do. Look around, you can see we have a spot over here that's not right. Now spots like this is because we've sanded through into the wood grain here. So I may have to resort to a little 3M filler there. Not sure yet, I'll sand it one more time. Or another choice, if it's not that low, I can just put some Brodak primer in a gun and just give it a very quick spritz. See, there's a little fingernail mark there. I think I put that in there. Some little dots up there. But the biggest thing is, it looks like we've got the seams pretty well. There's another spot right here, dry spot. In by the horn, we're not gonna see, that's gonna be inside the body. There's some spots here where there's a wood seam. See how the silver just shows that up. So again, it's going to be a repeat performance of yesterday. A little spot right here. And I'll do it off camera because I know you're getting bored. You think you're getting bored. I got to sand this. This will be a couple of hours. Look at this. A couple hours. And Karen loves this. Every time she comes home and there's a dirty sheet. Yesterday, the day before, we used her good pink sheet.
You were sanding! using silver again, Wendy! Oh.
Anyway, we'll get this sanded out. Maybe even get another coat of silver on it today.
That may be a good tip. What I've been doing, you can see in the little spots where I put my fingernail and other little things. Any little dings, this is good material. There's only one problem with this material. If you try to make fillets or try to do anything that's going to require structural strength, forget it. And it's 3M05960. Make it in various colors with various drying times. The green seems to work okay for me. Now what I do is once it's on a sill, I don't like to put it on raw wood. But once I put that on there, now by the time I sand out the other panel, what will happen, this will be ready to sand, and then we'll flip it, of course.
Now as I'm sanding this, I'm finding one thing, that I really need to get a little more paint to bury the joints. Because we have the double fiberglass, double tissue, a lot of material there. Well, using a sanding block is the easiest way to get that done. And in this case, we're trying to pick up high spots so that each coat of silver just fills just a little bit more than the one before it. And it gets boring, there's no doubt about it. But the point is, when you want to go after these little spots like this, every little thing, there's a little ding here. Every time you want to make it just a little bit better, you up the bar just a little bit. And it's really a personal thing. Do you want to just paint this and get it over with? Or when you put it out on a flying field or an appearance judging, do you want it to be the best it possibly can be? And whenever I have to make that decision, do I want to sand another hour or just leave it the way? I kind of favor just putting that extra hour in at this stage, right when you're doing the silver. This is the stage, and that's why I go over it over and over on most of the tapes. And a lot of people think, well, gee, he's overdoing it. No, when you want that final, look at this, but will you get out of here? When you want that final little bit, that little push, that up the bar thing, there's really only one way I know to get it, and that's just sanding out these coats of silver one right after another until it's perfect. Turn another perfectly good bed sheet into a silver mess. Anyway, now it's raining out there, so we're going to just put this aside to dry. We don't have the drawings for the nacelles yet, but I do have several other little projects I can work on, and we're not going to take any chances trying to spray this in the rain, that's for sure. I think we've met our objective of getting all the material, the silt span and the glass, going tip to tip. And I've never been a believer in, you know, you put the fuselage here and then just glass up to the fuselage. It's the center of things, and the center certainly of the nacelles in this case, that I want to be clamping to some solid, that leading edge is relatively solid. I want to be clamping to something a little solider than just 16th balsa wood. And I think we've built in a lot of span loading strength here and added no weight in doing it. Just by doing it this way instead of putting the nacelles on first and then doing up to the nacelles, I think we've gained this should be a better model and a lighter model because of having to do this first before we do the nacelles. And that's what it's like to be windy. Another rainy day. We're definitely not going to be able to paint, but luckily, the way we space out our building projects is always something to work on. Well, today we got up to what amounted to be that the warmest day we've had. It's like 60 degrees out there right now. I got this sprayed, and it looks like I can still see a couple of spots here and there I'm going to want to dress off. But for sure, I'm going to want it to dry inside. I don't want it drying outside now. It's already outgassed. And what I want to do while this is drying, it's going to need one more sand out maybe, but boy, when it's all set in silver, that wing really, I really think that's going to look nice. One of the things that I've been wanting to make for this plane, one of the features is replaceable motors. And I want to work on that a little bit while this is drying out. All of the silver that I sprayed today is just drying out like,
At 70 degrees, 60 degrees, when there's no humidity, the stuff just dries up in a half an hour. It's so nice. Anyway, now it's been forever that we've used the traditional mounting system, and we may go back to using it after this experience with the control system. Where we drill two holes right through the motor, through the aluminum, and using little wood screws, screw the pads in place. And that's been, I'm guessing, the last 25 years, that's been the way all motors are mounted. You never want to mount a motor right to wood. It just crushes in and gets all distorted. It distorts the fuselage and whatever. So that's been our traditional way, but we're going to try to come up with, and again, it doesn't matter if you fail, like we did with the universal joints and stuff, because we have really added knowledge to the database. What is important, though, is to learn what you can do and what you can't do, and not just guess at it, to really know. An example of knowledge that you gain virtually every day when you do this kind of work is some of my EPON 862 that I make the fuel tanks with. I've been making fuel tanks every day this week, trying to get some shells made so that when it comes time to put the tanks in this plane, I already have made. One of the things is the resin had some crystals in it. Well, we know, for instance, with SIG 5-minute epoxy, you can put it in hot water and the crystals go away. But I found out something significant, that up to about 180 degrees, and I put a thermometer in that water, put the EPON in there, let it sit in there until the water cools, it totally decrystallizes it. And that, now see, I was not aware of that. I had always thought there was a shelf life of about 18 months on this. It's about 18 months since we bought this. But Gary had told me from, he's the tech, and by the way, Shell Oil doesn't own the epoxy company anymore. It's owned by another company. They sold it off. All epoxy, every type of epoxy, is prone to crystal. And when it does, you can remove the crystals just by putting it in water. And in this case, Gary recommended 180 degrees. But I'm sure for the lower grade epoxies, probably 120, 130 is fine. But it just decrystallizes it, turns it back into a clear liquid. Another tip we learn, what I'm prone to do is make little databases. See, for instance, just as an example of what I do, I have the guy at the tech, I have his name, I have the toll-free number, I have all the little notes that he's given me over the years, all the little stuff crystallized. I make notes as soon as I learn something, and I always save all the data from all these materials that we use. All the little information that you can get, it's always so important to have a little data, like Tom has for those motors, that the timing on those motors. Things I always do, I buy these from Microfasteners. Their phone number is 800-892-6917. These are real heavy duty blind nuts. They're a little bit larger than the hobby shop variety. I always buy machinist grade bolts. They're alloy 632x1, again from Microfasteners. Then what we do is Jimmy Snyder makes up about 500 of these at a time, the pads, and we sell them. We used to drill them out, but we didn't have good luck with people that had elongated the holes on their motors and stuff, so now the only way we sell them is without the holes in them. Now, this is a good way to mount the motor for sure, but what we want to do now is try to make that clamping action similar to what we have in Strega, and figure a way of keying it in. And I've thought about this. What I want to do now, I got a little bit of time here tonight, it's just while all our paint is drying up, make a little test. Before we get away from this, Sylvia, I wanted to put this on a video. A lot of times you get the 3M putty, and we've been using this for the last couple of days on filling little dings in. What happens though, in time, as time goes by, it gets a little bit too, I don't know, dries out, I guess is the right word. Now, the way to get rid of it, a couple of drops of Brodak thinner. That's another good tip. It only takes a couple of drops of Brodak thinner. Now, that's the right consistency, so it's got to be just thin enough that it paints on, I guess a little thinner than peanut butter. But we still have little flaws that I want to work on. I'm not going to be satisfied with even one little ding in that wing. Now, as of right now, this is the motor that we have all run in already. The Weber 32, this was worked on by Tom Hampshire, broken in. It was Dave Cook, who's using a Sato 72 and has his infrared system working already. Couple little notations here, even though I'm going to try to make this adjustable mount. This is one of the things we're going to replace. Elliot was going to find us, we haven't gotten him yet, some smaller, lighter carburetors. If anybody has some smaller, lighter carburetors they'd like to donate, a pair, or if they have any way of... This is just, you can see how big the throat is. This is a, I'll call it, for lack of a better word, a maximum power setup here. You can see a nice, that goes into its idling mode. But I'm not interested in this. I'd like smaller carburetors for sure. But I want to look at, when I mount up the pads, so I don't want to make them any smaller. Maybe I can even use the stock spacing. I don't know. What I'm going to have to do is just make a little test up before I make a crutch. I'm going to make up, this is just a little test here. I'm going to just drill these out for 632 bolts and blind nuts, just to see if this is going to be practical. Again, I have a little time here tonight, waiting for my green putty to dry up. We'll see if we can make a little prototype here. This was just my little test of what I wanted to envision here. The problem is, as you move these bolts further out, of course, this is going to bend. So we're going to have to figure a way. I'm going to see Jimmy about this, of maybe moving these bolts in just a little bit. Or another thing we could do, you don't know until you lay one of these up, is put the standard hole spacing in, and also put some holes with 632 blind nuts out here. In fact, because this is not a 60, we may even get away with using 440 bolts, not sure. 632 is always a little bit better, I think. We'll find out when we get time to do this. But I'm going to show this to Jimmy. Now, what my idea was, I guess we're going to find out if this works. See, I can take this apart, and you can just take the motor right out. Now, this can stay right in the plane. Of course, you got to take the top one off. And I didn't do this only because I had these already sitting here. But I wanted to try, and then possibly this top piece could be some channel stuff, or maybe even 3/16, because we're going to order special material for this job. Now, here's what I thought would be worth trying, is to take a piece of tape, take one piece of this. I'm sure everybody's already figured out what I'm going to try to do here. Because I want to have the choice of using a lot of different motors. I really don't want to be locked into only having one or two choices. Now, if I put this back together, I think you probably already figured out what I'm going to try to do. What it would mean is every time you want to change, see right now, every time you want to change the motor in a plane, you got to drill more holes, or you have to take the motors and butcher them all up. Nobody likes to take their brand new whatever and butcher it all up. Now, if I put that motor in here, okay, and what it would mean is I could set my offset. I could have a little bit of front to back because it's a radial cowl. But by putting this in place, now let's just see if this works, because I could put some pen marker or whatever on the clamps. See, these are just a little too long, so I know right away I'm going to have to shorten up the spacing. Still no problem. These can all be drilled, you know. But the idea of this was, now I have a little impression here. not as much as I wanted. I'm going to have to put some ink marker in where I can see where the motor pressed in. But what I wanted to do then, of course, if I had this, I would put some ink marker in, and I would have an impression here of where this mount's going to be. Drill and tap this so that I could just tap in the top piece, would have some screws just confining it, and yet still I'd have a universal mount. So this looks like something I'm going to think about a little more, but certainly looks like something that we will try to make it work on the B-25. Again, my conclusion from this first little test is we need to move these bolts closer to the mounts by some. These are just a little bit too far apart. Well, I can do that. That's going to be something that, again, I wanted to make up a little prototype here. Just to look at how this would look in real life. The thing I like about it, of course, is I don't have to butcher up the motors, and I'll be able to tap one of these screws in here, and actually I can just have a 632 bolt sticking down into the motor by one thread or something. In case these loosen up, the motor can't slide forward, but could also look at maybe knurling one side of this, knurling both sides. Because we have Jimmy Snyder on a B-25 team, I'm going to try to approach him about it. We're going to see him with the cowling, I hope the cowling mold in the next couple of days. Anyway, we'll be thinking about more on this. This was a good little thing. I feel more comfortable now seeing how that laid out. Yeah, just one example of a little spot we wanted to do. Little fingernail marks. Little dry spots we'll coat with some clear. Little spots out here I wasn't happy with. The trick is to just pick away at them, be patient, until that whole wing looks like an aluminum billet, carved from a billet of aluminum. A little flaw like this. We're at the point where we don't have to really re-sand the whole wing. We can just do spot, I'll call it spot touch-ups. Or I can just spot that right in. And actually, we've taken so much out that the only green that remains, you see that little bit of green in there? That's the only spot that was low on that. Now, the same thing we're going to do over here. We have a couple little areas here. Just by blocking them in. Yeah, this has been a very educational week. Learned a lot of stuff. It was good talking to Dave Cook. Glad he's got his IR cooking along. Cooking along. Now, something like this, I like to sand very carefully because I don't want to go and create low spots here. So just keep wiping each time. No matter how careful you are, there's always little sanding nicks and dings and little spots you need to touch up. Yeah. Let me tell you, look, he comes over here, humiliates himself. He finally made the wheel pants. Okay. Now, aren't you glad I forced you to do that? Aren't you
glad? I don't know. They
admit it.
They weigh a lot.
You weigh a lot. How can you have a stinker with no wheel? God. You know, Matt Newman's been emailing me. He says, make sure he makes the wheel pants. They look okay.
Pants.
You want to glass them, though?
Yeah, I will.
Fiberglass them. Yeah.
I will. That, but
so you don't get
on.
A little ding in it.
Put more weight on.
So, you're putting more weight on.
I am.
Now, you didn't bring the plane. So he wants me to make him a custom tune pipe.
I want you to cut the pipe. This pipe is...
You
want to
cut it here?
Yeah. The problem is...
Gee, what are you doing?
The header that I have, this is an inch and a...
That's an inch and a half?
Yeah.
And where's the plane? Oh, you didn't bring the plane.
No, I didn't bring the plane.
Oh, he wants the... Oh, what is he else he got in the jiffy bag?
That's all.
Well, I'm glad you made the... We could change the pipe anytime. That's no problem. What's... I would glass these for sure, though.
I will, but
it was that thin.
I thought maybe.
So how much did that weigh? An ounce?
Wimp. And you need the big wheels anyway. You're going to fly at the circle burner field, right?
I'm going to make another landing gear without the wheel pants.
You sure?
Yeah.
You're like just for flying on grass?
Just to fly on the circle burners.
Now, you've heard it from him. Now, he goes and listen to this goody kind. This is why I can't be business partners with him. He finds these real ultralight wheels from?
Two pair.
No. He finds them. He pays the $4 shipping. Does he get two pairs and give one to me?
No, because actually... Oh.
How much are these wheels cost? $4?
Yeah, something like that.
Four. You know how much it's going to cost to fix this pipe?
Listen.
Take a guess. $25.
Listen, I didn't know what kind of wheels I was getting.
But I need those.
I was ordering them from a catalog.
Why don't you? You're going to give me the catalog?
Now that we know they're good.
We know. You know. What we? Is this Lindbergh going across the Atlantic or something? You better show up with, I'm going to keep the pipe until I have two sets of wheels. And let me give you the diameter on the wheels, too. Go measure those wheels so you know what size they should be. Trust me, he's going to pay for that pipe modification.
That was fun. We're gonna work on this tune pipe problem that Rich has for his Stuka. Ron Merrill sent me this, and of course, because we sell Sato's, I'm interested in everything Sato. And it's from an RC magazine. I'll check this out. I always get a kick out of how in some of these situations they overlook one thing that I see is this is a potential engine for anybody who makes a plane with a short nose. I think you could redo this, and Ron of course has one already, and we've already run it in fact. It is a talker. Now, he's talking about making a giant biplane, and boy, am I excited about that, because one of the things I'm excited about,
when we make this B-25 cowl, it may be that there'll be some people in the real world, it's a 5-inch diameter cowl, that will be able to use it,
and you can picture this in a big radial cowl with the rocker arms looking out at you. Just a great thing, and I appreciate it a whole lot, Ron.
How old you are now? We've been recording you since you were a baby. How old
Six.
Are you? Six?
Mm-hmm.
Oh my God, I can't believe how big you were.
My birthday.
Lena Borelli.
Lena, did you give him that chicken? He's got a big piece of chicken.
No, I didn't.
You sure?
I'm sure.
Anyway, we have Bob Lampione, Jimmy Borelli and his daughter and wives, Lorraine and Debbie are here.
Huh? He flew right at the bottom.
See if he'll come out of the cage.
I don't think he knows that. I don't think he wants to fly right now.
How's that, Lena?
He just flew right down.
Oh!
He flew on your shoulder again.
Get away from those eyes, Chicky. 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 Chicky, I shaved already today. Stop it. Chicky! Chicky, I'm not kidding. I'm not a pincushion, Chicky. Chicky? Chicky, this isn't funny, you know. This is not funny. I don't know, Lena. This is not what I pay him to do.
No.
Chicky, there are no bugs in my head. Oh, Chicky, you're going to live with Brodax. That's all there is to it. Here we have a nice social evening, and the bird is not behaving. The bird is misbehaving. Who's cuter, Chicky? Baby Lena or Baby Wendy?
I don't know. I'll take Lena, though. Forget it.
I think he's at Lena.
Forget it. Is he a cute baby or what?
Yep.
Did you feed him? I want you to sing the chickens and sheep. Sing chickens and sheep. Chickens and sheep. Our lovely daughter has a new song out called
chickens and sheep. Where's the new CD? Look at this. You guys live in Anaheim or what?
I wish I wanted to see you for longer. Next time I'll have to come over.
Okay.
My house, okay?
Listen, try not to eat all that fudge on the way into the city, huh?
I hope I get to see you soon.
I hope I get to see you too.
Yeah. Lady, you want to take Peeps home with you?
No.
Hey, Rob, there's our daughter on the cover of Current. Oh, my God, Stacy Rose. Can you believe that?
She's a star.
Karen, I know.
You must be so proud.
Proud? We want a cut of the money. The hell with proud is cheap.
You know, this Wendy's always practical. Where's the
when she
where's
gets,
the money?
Lorraine, when she gets her first hit record, I get a new Ducati out of the deal.
Oh, yeah?
Money. Wow.
Does this work? That's a real newspaper.
No, it doesn't.
It's too big.
It's
too big.
It's a phony.
I'm making pay calls on my end.
Hey.
Who are you calling, Gene Schaefer?
I did. He said he didn't want to talk to any more.
Yeah, why don't you guys come and see her? This Thursday she's playing again?
Yes.
Oh, my God.
No,
where did you find this old store?
An antique?
No, I made it.
Down the
I made that on video. That's another Windy Video project, making the stove.
It's really cool.
Yeah, and there's Karen's new electric stove.
Yeah.
Spitfires.
But which one is the first one built?
This one, right?
From right to left.
From right, oh, okay.
And the last one was the I-beam one. Seafire's in the middle.
I don't think I ever seen
Spitfire's on the end.
Hello.
That one I remember.
Mike's Cardinal with the 72.
Hello.
And the Typhoon, just Spitfire bedrooming up,
this
baby.
This is Mike.
Mike Kajewski.
Oh,
Mike Kajewski, yeah.
Those
little silver parts are over on the army cot in the Spitfire bedroom.
Pretty wild, eh?
I think it's fun.
I think it is. It is. You got a kit. A George Harris Magnificent.
Yeah, John Brodak gave me that kit. This is from Walter's father up here.
That's cool, yeah.
Gerald Champ sent me this, the little Mustang. All kinds of cool little stuff.
Where's those little planes the guy gave you?
Over there, the little Mustangs.
These little ones?
Yeah, I got a whole collection of them.
Ed Brodak?
Yep. Oh, no, they're by the radio. The little... Open up by the...
Oh, yeah.
Okay. And the radio plays World War II. The radio, when you turn it on? Yeah.
There was going to be a rally around. As soon as the woman meant she was going to stay...
It's a World War II radio.
Oh, it's a recording.
Yeah, it's a recording. And here's where the doodlebugs crashed in Kent. It's just a whole lot of fun having this Spitfire bedroom. Just absolutely fun. And Bobby's going to give me a nice set of pictures here at the usual price.
I would like to have that many concourse products.
Well, you got one.
I got one.
Okay, well, one is better. Some people don't have any.
One is better than most people don't have any. Bobby Baron, when Bobby was alive,
look at that. Bob Baron
was amazing. Looked so healthy here in a year, maybe he was gone.
Less than a year later, yeah.
We don't have the real, and I'll call them the real, for lack of a better word, the updated, the stretched version of the nacelles yet, the ones that Dave Downey wants me to use. So what I'm trying to do is segment out a couple other jobs that I wanted to do. One of them is I wanted to glue the rudders onto the stab. They're pretty much in the final coat of silver, or at least the last coat. So I want to glue those on, because it'll allow me to then, when it comes time to lay out the plane, I can lay it out with the wing in place and tail, and I can kind of get a feel for how it's going to look in its final version. Getting the tank bodies made up, so I'll have all the parts to make the tanks. At the same time, we're making the nacelles. The molds are all apart. These are going to be the tank bodies for the B-25. We're working on this to get a couple extra parts, maybe make a spare tank while we're making them. Another project we need to zip up, but I want to get those rudders on. That's one of the things I've been waiting, just so I can lay the plane out and see it in one piece. Now, I thought I was going to get the tails put on today, but we have a pile of mail like I've never seen. And this is the first thing. This is really funny. I'll get these in. This will probably be the end of the video. We're getting near the end. This is for Wendy Buttafuoco. Take a wild guess who it's from.
Oh,
Anyway, Jeff says, here's some pictures of his latest stunt weapon. Haven't flown it yet. What do you think my buddy Warren will think of the name? Look at the name, Buttafuoco. Oh.
Hey! Get!
He's eating it. Actually, it isn't Buttafuoco, but I won't say it on the video. You can ask Jeff. I think it's in poor taste. I think it's in terribly poor taste, in fact. In fact, I'm not even going to have that on my video. Jeff, that's terrible. Let's see if we can do this. This is called editing. This is what, when you edit, you're supposed to do. He probably put that on with some take-off lettering. Jeff, if you come to the net, I'm not even going to hang around with you. That's in bad taste. And he closes out his note with, I can't wait to get my hands on Goat Woman. Now, Goat Woman works in a pizza place, and she's one of the people we see every year. And he harasses her. Because when she laughs, she goes, Jeff, the whole thing's in bad taste. In fact, I'm editing this note out right now. This note is going in a dumpster. See, that's what happens when people do things in bad taste and you're the editor. See, the European thing. Anyway, we do have some nice mail today. So, Jeff, you're in bad taste. Anyway, these are from Paul Winter, another guy who's not always in good taste. Winter is one classic example of somebody who has, I think through the videos, learned an awful lot and upgraded his skills. Now, if we could only send them to like a dog training school or something where we could teach him the personal skills necessary to be a well-liked person in a world of stunt, we'd have it made. Anyway, Paul didn't write any real captions here. Paul, you gotta write captions. I think it's safe to say all the guys in England are benefiting from the videos. I hope that's true. And I also got, while I'm going through this, a letter from Bruce Hunt, who sends us a lot of stuff, a lot of video, in fact, building a take-apart impact with a foam wing. So he's finding all of the tips and tricks to be very timely. So Bruce, I hope you're enjoying it. Now, you know how I had to harass... Well, it was terrible. I had to harass Rich Jacobone to build the wheel pants. I had to harass Paul Winter to put the lettering on. Tsunami without lettering. Come on. Anyway, this looks pretty good. Sato 72, by the way. This is Joseph Gabris, stuntmaster. At least he's got the caption on here. Oh, wrong picture. See, it shows you what I know. This is Joseph Gabris. Paul, you got to write captions. It's unbelievable. Anyway, nice to have these pictures, and we'll pass them on to Stunt News, of course. The trick here is, you know, if you're going to send in some pictures, Paul, I don't know which is which. You got to write captions. We'll put all the pictures on, but we need captions. Closing this video out. The Super Bowl is this weekend, and some guy drives past my house, parks in front of it, and he has, I thought it said Gorham's. I didn't know what the hell he was talking about. It's for the Super Bowl. It's Go Rams. Anyway, even though he has Go Rams, I'm going with New England. Hey, Bill Belichick, believe me, when that game's over, Bill Belichick is going to be the king of the world. Anyway. Well, with all the mail done today, there's no chance we're going to get to work on this. But we're at the end of the tape, and several of these projects, we're just going to have to wait. We're going to work on the motor mount. We're going to try to join the tail on the next tape, and hopefully start the nacelles. We'll have those drawings here. And if we run out of things to do, this dope is probably about ready to buff. We could even put a couple days in on buffing out Miss Ashley. Lots of projects. This has been one of the busiest winters. Business has grown, I don't know why. It's just been a great year. And thanks to everybody for your support, and most of all, share the videos and share the hobby with all the people we love. Well, we hope you'll be joining us on the next tape, and we're coming down a home stretch here. I hope those no-sitting nacelles are gonna be done, and it'll lay it all out on the floor, and it'll be in one piece soon.